What if her bravery is a symptom?
The amygdala near the hippocampus. You blindly cut in there, you kill her. Any time you're gonna see this clot is at autopsy.
Then let's do that.
Okay, go.
Whoa, so House believes that what is obscuring the clot is the patient's blood. All he needs to find the clot then is to casually drain her blood. You may be surprised to hear though, you need blood to live. So House makes the easy solution, kill her temporarily. Something like this has actually been done before, in all fairness. Very excited to be reacting to House MD Season 2, Episode 2, Autopsy. On this channel, we are reacting to all 177 House episodes, and this will be Episode 51. Let's see if I can get the diagnosis before House does, as a doctor working in London. What a brave girl to be able to inject herself like that as a kid is special. There are definitely adults who can't self-inject in that way. Seems like she has cancer, is going through chemotherapy, and is taking her meds and then had a hallucination. Hallucinations are way more common in cancer patients than you might think, with 28% of patients experiencing them. The absolute number one cause of this will be delirium, which can be triggered by an infection, which she will be susceptible to because of immunosuppression from the chemo, but that's way too obvious. So what else could this be? A medication side effect, like if she's taking voriconazole or painkillers, a blood electrolyte abnormality, the beginning of Parkinson's disease, a brain tumor, either primary or spread from a distant cancer site, primary psychosis like schizophrenia is another option. Let's find out more.
I got a 9-year-old with cancer, alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma. She's hallucinating.
So the rhabdo's in her brain.
Yeah, except there is no cancer in her brain. It's all negative.
Cancer is in remission.
This may shock you, but 1 in 2 of us will develop some form of cancer in our lifetime. Some of us will die with it as just a low-grade nuisance, like an in-law that won't leave no matter how hard you hoover. Others will die from it. So what's happening to this patient could be relevant to any of us at some stage, but I really hope not. Interestingly, so her CT head, blood tests, and protein markers were all negative, so House thinks the cancer is in remission. That isn't actually the case, especially for this type of cancer, as it doesn't have a direct blood marker that can correspond with disease severity. The way you would see if it's in remission is by scanning the area that it's in, and it sounds like they just scan the head, not the whole body. There is some confusion about the word remission as well, because why would we want to use words people could understand? Many people think that it means that the cancer has just disappeared. Remission can be partial or complete. Partial means some of the signs and symptoms of cancer are there, but they're reduced. And complete remission means that all the signs of symptoms of cancer have disappeared, even though there could still be cancer in the body. There's always a risk after complete remission that a cancer can come back, and we call that a cancer recurrence. How common that is depends on the actual cancer type. It can be as high as 100% in glioblastoma, a very aggressive brain cancer, or as low as 5% in hormone-sensitive breast cancer. So even if this patient's cancer is gone, it could just be hiding, waiting to strike, or maybe it was never cancer in the first place. Let's find out.
Get a tox screen, an MRI.
Sore throat?
What's that, lupus?
My new girlfriend never been with a guy who wasn't circumcised.
Huh?
I got some box cutters.
This man was so desperate that he was willing to cut off his own foreskin at home to try and get some action. Well, that's one way to get rid of blue balls. Now they're red. You'd think that people doing procedures on themselves would be a rare occurrence, but you'd be wrong. Just 2 days ago, I had a 32-year-old patient who had a mole that was growing on his back. I had a look, told him it was benign, and we could cut it off if it's bothering him, and he said, "No, you're busy. Just tell me how to do it. Should I get a kitchen knife or just tie a band on it and wait for it to fall off?"
Brilliant.
There have been people who successfully operated on themselves, though, like Russian surgeon called Rogozov in the 60s that had to cut out his own appendix during an expedition to the Antarctic. Moral of the story, always take two doctors with you on a remote expedition, or just cut out your appendix before you go. Question for you smart people. What percentage of people get appendicitis? Answer down below.
Andy's MRI and tox screen were clean.
Oxygen saturation is 94%. Check her heart, get some arterial blood gases. Once you confirm that she is hypoxic, what a plethysmography, chest x-ray, CT, and BQ.
House's thought process here is the more investigations I can give them, the less likely they are to bother me. He says he's suffering from hay fever, which I can very much relate to, as pollen counts have been astronomically high here. The UK is the only place that can have a high pollen count and be cloudy all at once. Now, if you noticed, what House did with his team's instructions here was what Cal Newport in his book Deep Work calls a multi-stage instruction. Rather than just replying to an email, you can give instructions on what to do for the next step and the one after that. It reduces the amount of distractions that affect you, as every time you get distracted, it can take up to 30 minutes to refocus on your original task again, as the studies show. That's because to get into that flow state, the brain needs to load all that background context information and linked memories to process things at maximum functioning. It's also why when you try and think of someone's name, you may not be able to initially, and then as soon as you remember it, you start remembering some key information about them as well, like what their favorite food is or the last place they went on holiday. If you're interested in finding out how to achieve that flow state, then check out Deep Work with a free trial of Audible Premium Plus. Link is in the description below. Even by joining the free trial, you're supporting the channel, as I get a small kickback from that. Thank you for your support.
I never kissed a boy. Will you kiss me?
No.
No one will ever know.
What? Not okay, Chase. I know he did it as a friendly thing because she's dying and that was her last opportunity, but I can see the Daily Mail headlines already. Handsome Australian doctor uses authority to groom vulnerable cancer patient. You may think patients hitting on their doctor doesn't happen much, but it's actually fairly common. I was once running a cardiothoracic pre-op clinic and a guy and his wife in their 50s came in to see me. I did some of the initial consultation, checking their investigations, then just went out to get a skin marker to make sure we didn't take out the wrong lung. As soon as I came back to them both in the room, the husband said, "My wife thinks you're dishy." Initially, I thought they had a friend called Dishy, which I had been mistakenly identified as, but the internet clarified it for me. Apparently it means very sexually attractive and desirable, yet troubling for reasons hard to explain. Always a good idea to give a backhanded compliment for someone who's about to take out your lung.
Pulmonary angiogram of Andy's lungs was clean. Arterial blood gases and CT scan were also normal. Her heart and lungs are fine.
Pulmonary angiogram of Andy's lungs was clean. Blood gases and CT scans were also normal. Wait, a pulmonary angiogram is a CT scan. That's like saying your blood test was normal and your blood test was normal. Seems like Chase's kiss to the patient has glitched the matrix and he's got deja vu. Now, it's tough for the team to say that the heart is fine here because yes, they have a picture of it with the CT, but is it working properly? Like, if you go to buy a used phone from Facebook Marketplace, are you gonna pick it up and be like, "Yeah, it looks fine, here, have $400. Or are you gonna switch it on and make sure it doesn't explode first? Them saying the heart is okay here is like taking the phone without switching it on. So how do we make sure the heart is actually okay? We need to see it moving in full live action, lubbing and dubbing. We do that with an ultrasound probe, and on the heart, we call it an echocardiogram. We can check the valves, the pressure in the lungs, and how the muscle of the heart is working. Then if that's okay and they've looked at the coronary arteries, then you can say the heart is all right. We're really not getting many new clues on this case. Pretty tough one.
There is one infection we didn't test for because of her age. Neurosyphilis.
There's no way.
You think she's been molested?
She asked me to kiss her. If she's never kissed a boy, it's a fair bet she's never had sex.
Tell that to all the hookers who won't kiss behind the mouth.
If House makes one more hooker joke, we need to swap out his walking stick with a pimp cane. Brilliantly timed though. Chase is worried now. If they go down the sexual assault route, they could find his DNA on her lips, and that will raise questions. This must be exactly what happened with Michael Jackson. So Foreman thinks she has neurosyphilis, which is insanely unlikely, as this is a type of tertiary syphilis. To explain why that is, you need to know the phases of syphilis infection. After exposure to syphilis, a spiral-shaped bacterium known as Treponema pallidum starts to replicate inside the body. After just 2 to 6 weeks, it can cause syphilis's primary symptoms. That is a classic sign known as a chancre, which causes non-itchy skin ulceration, usually close to the area of entry of the bacteria with the skin. This happens in 40% of people, but otherwise the infection goes totally under the radar until you develop secondary syphilis, and that phase is between 4 and 10 weeks after the primary infection, can involve skin, mucus and lymph nodes. The characteristic sign is something called condyloma latum, where broad, whitish, wart-like lesions appear. These harbor bacteria and are infections. Now, between 20 and 65% of patients who develop secondary syphilis do not report having symptoms of primary infection. The last stage of syphilis infection is tertiary syphilis, which can be anywhere from 3 to 15 years after infection. This includes what Foreman's talking about, neurosyphilis, and can lead to something called gummate formation, which are these huge bumps on the head. We should show this in sex ed clinic. No wonder teens are more likely to use perfect grammar than condoms.
You did it, didn't you?
One kiss for a dying girl.
Her SAT percentage dropped another point, which means there's a tumor in her heart.
Tuberous sclerosis in a kid that also has alveolar rhabdomyosarcoma?
A lot to go through here. House found out that Chase kissed the girl and thought that was a clear sign she was being abused, since she's having fantasies about Chase, which is overly sexual for a 9-year-old. Cameron examined her though and found no signs of abuse. Now her oxygen levels are dropping, but her CT lung scan is normal. So House has concluded that there is a tumor in her heart. How has he got to that conclusion? I'll never know. Especially since Wilson has said that they've now done an echo and cardiac MRI, which were both normal. Wilson thinks that whatever affects the heart is also affecting the brain, which now brings us to the wonderful world of multiple tumor syndromes. Tuberous sclerosis is one, von Hippel-Lindau is another, neurofibromatosis type 1 or schwannomatosis could also cause it. A PET scan is going to be the next step in finding these tiny tumors, looking for hot spots of high uptake. Is that what the team will do though? Assuming we still have a team and Chase hasn't been charged, lost his license, and become a surfing instructor.
I downloaded the audio of her echocardiogram.
There's an extra flap.
I'm going to ask the surgeon to look at the mitral valve first.
They found a tumor. It's in her lung, extending into her heart. The surgeon has to temporarily remove Andy's heart.
What? That escalated quickly. 1 minute we're in the locker room listening to heart sounds, and then we're taking out a child's heart. Definitely some things to go through here. Firstly, Cameron mentioned that there is a third flap that she could hear. What does that actually mean? What are the doctors even listening to when we listen to heart sounds? Usually it's a lub-dub, lub-dub, lub-dub. The sound we hear is of valves closing. So the lub is the mitral and tricuspid valves closing as the lower part of the heart squeezes to push the blood out. You'll notice that the aortic and pulmonary valves open when that happens as blood flows out. Then the second heart sound is the valves outside the ventricles closing as the ventricles or bottom side of the heart relaxes. So what we're hearing is the aortic and pulmonary valves closing, not the number of valve leaflets like Cameron said. We know that because some people have 2 aortic valve leaflets instead of 3 and actually have the same sound on listening with a stethoscope. What we actually heard with that sound was something called an S3 gallop, which is produced when a large amount of blood hits a dilated, stretchy left ventricle. Causes of this can be severe mitral regurgitation, dilated cardiomyopathy, or heart failure. That is definitely not what we're seeing in this patient, but sure makes for good television. The echo is less about the sounds we hear, though, and more about the pictures we see. Cardiac tumors are usually quite easily visualized, and we have 3D echoes now, which, believe it or not, have more use than taking photos of footballers' wives' babies to post as their Instagram profile photo. So why do we need to now take her heart out, which is called a cardiac explant? Their justification is that it's a tricky procedure to remove the tumor from the heart wall and replace it with a graft from a cow. So rather than struggling away, doing that in the chest, they'll just take it out. This is an incredibly rare procedure that has only been done 6 times in history, and for good reasons, because the average survival is only 8 months after that. With that in mind, I may choose to take my chances in the US, especially since just this type of operation can cost between $150 and $200,000 in the US, depending on the complexity of the surgery. Now, the question is, why does she keep getting these tumors? The histology and samples they get from the tumor should give us more clues.
Dr. Murphy? She's got a bleed in her eye.
The cardiac tumor was benign.
Are you trying to say that the tumor threw a clot before we removed it?
Angio was clean.
There's no clot?
There's a clot. You just can't find it.
I love how we're in a murder mystery, but the villain is a disease and the venue is the body. So beautiful. So it seems like this hematoma of the eye, the team think was due to a clot, but they can't find it. That is surprising, as the type of bleed that was demonstrated doesn't actually exist. It seems like they were trying to simulate something called a subconjunctival hemorrhage, which can look incredibly dramatic but doesn't live up to the hype. Kind of like when your wife forces you to go to the opera. You see, the bleeding usually stops at a place called the corneal limbus, also more practically known as the corneoscleral junction, which forms a barrier in the superficial layers. If the bleeding goes from deeper layers, then it is called a bloody chemosis, and it can go into the cornea and be a medical emergency, but looks nothing like what we saw. Subconjunctival hemorrhage would be tough to recreate unless you hit her with a hammer, but it would be tough to film the scene on the way to the emergency room. So let's assume the eye symptom is actually from the clot. We now know that she had a benign heart tumor, a lung tumor, likely a seizure which caused the hallucinations, and we can't find any brain stuff on the scan. Firstly, we would want to take a sample of that spinal fluid, since we definitely need more clues and we've established that something's going on in the brain here. Secondly, what could this be? Gotta be tuberous sclerosis, multiple benign tumors, the involvement of the heart, lungs, and brain, and absence of positive blood markers. It's usually a neurocutaneous syndrome, though, which means there should be some signs on the skin, like tumor growths under the fingernails, which we call subungual hyperkeratosis, and little growths on the skin. It would be atypical, but considering we've seen him infect his own teammate with a deadly disease to save his life, it's not that atypical. Only be able to control the symptoms, though, and not treat the condition. So maybe that's why it's called autopsy, or maybe it's not her that we need to autopsy. It's a dead pet that she has at home, or maybe she's so immunosuppressed that she has an oncovirus, like the one that causes Kaposi's sarcoma, and that is why she keeps getting the tumors. That would be an insane diagnosis. You'd usually find that from a biopsy, though, but let's see. This just got very interesting. Now, if you think Kaposi's sarcoma is a spicy diagnosis, then check out the channel membership. You get priority reply to comments, early access to new videos, and being able to suggest a series and episode for me to react to. For a limited time only, the first 30 members have a chance to win a 1 hour one-on-one tutor session with me on a topic of your choice. We currently have 22 members with only 8 spots left that are filling fast, so make sure to join now and secure your spot. The earlier you join, the earlier I can react to your suggestion, so press join now.
She's gonna die.
Well, the clot's not gonna go away quietly. I wanna see how brave she is when you tell her she's gonna die.
What's wrong with this picture? Cancer girl told she's dying. Mother starts crying. A 9-year-old, lucid, intelligent girl is doing a stronger cold steel than Zoolander. Easy explanations are she doesn't understand fully or can't comprehend death, and they might work if the girl was younger or had impaired mental functioning, but she just doesn't. So the problem must be somewhere in the emotion processing center in her brain. I don't think she's gonna die. I think House just needs to look closer at the source, and maybe this is his treasure map. Of course, none of this would happen in real life. You'd see any clinically significant clot on the angiogram, but this is very interesting to watch. This reminds me of a time when I was on cardiac surgery, and this 47-year-old patient who just had a triple bypass operation was breathless on walking. He had similar symptoms before his surgery, so we thought one of his grafts could be blocked, or maybe he had a chest infection, but it all came out clean. He was on the usual blood thinning protocol, but was a heavy guy, around 110 kilos. I was looking at his chart one day, wrecking my brain on the day that he complained of his symptom as to why this guy wasn't breathing well. My boss told me that it was probably because he had just had cardiac surgery, saturations are normal, and he just needs to get up and mobilize more. I noticed though that on his chart, his dose of blood thinner was for someone between 50 and 100 kilos, not his 110 kilos, so that was inadequate for him. So I stuck a probe on him, and even though his saturations were normal at rest, they dropped as we went walking. As soon as I noticed that, I put him on treatment dose heparin, and we got him a CTPA, found a big clot in his lungs that he was compensating for as a young guy, stuck him on those blood thinners for a bit longer, and within 2 days, he said that he felt better than he has ever remembered. Clots are such an important thing to not miss.
What if her bravery is a symptom?
The amygdala near the hippocampus. You blindly cut in there, you kill her. Only time you're gonna see this clot is that autopsy.
Then let's do that.
Okay, go.
Whoa, so House believes that what is obscuring the clot is the patient's blood. All he needs to find the clot then is to casually drain her blood. You may be surprised to hear though, you need blood to live. So House makes the easy solution, kill her temporarily. Something like this has actually been done before, in all fairness, on rabbits. We also regularly intentionally stop people's heart on cardiac surgery. I remember assisting in a 22-year-old patient's aortic arch replacement operation. Now, when we're doing that, we don't want the heart beating air, as all of the heart's workload is taken over by the bypass machine. So we inject a chemical called Cardioplegic, which consists of nutrients and high-dose potassium, as you see the heart slowly change rhythm. First, you get these peaked T waves, then a widening of the QRS as the electrical activity of the heart slowly gets dysregulated, and then it goes into this sinusoidal pattern and the heart just stops. This is why eating too many bananas can be dangerous, although you'd have to eat them on an OnlyFans level to get to the end stages. This whole thing about bravery as a symptom reminded me of someone called Alex Honnold, the famous free climber who climbed El Capitan, a 2.3 kilometer rock face in Yosemite in record time with no rope. They did some fMRI studies on his brain and found that his amygdala, the fear center of the brain, was basically a lump of charcoal. I guess Santa got creative one Christmas. Now let's see if they find this clot.
Start the cooling. She's shivering, 200 milligrams of vecuronium.
Whoa. 200 milligrams of vecuronium. Is he trying to kill her before he kills her? So vecuronium is a paralytic agent, and the usual dose is 80 to 100 milligrams per kilo. Now we know she is 9, so the traditional way to calculate weight would be the advanced life support formula. That is age plus 4 multiplied by 2. How fast is your maths? That would put her weight at 26 kilos. The problem with that formula though is the older the child gets, the more it underestimates weight. The average underestimation is 33% as well, which can make a difference if you're giving life-saving drugs, which we usually are in a situation where we even need to use a formula and can't just put the kid on the scales like a reasonable person. So there is another formula to calculate the weight. 3 times by age plus 7. Fast maths, that would give us 34 kg, which is a better estimate. So even if we gave the top end of the dose calculation, then that would give us 100 micrograms per kilo, which would be 3,400 micrograms or 3.4 milligrams. So House has just given a 60 times overdose. You may say, oh, he's killing it anyway. Why does it matter? And it matters, smarty pants, because we want it to be temporary and not permanent. No point fixing the clot in her head if she's in respiratory arrest.
We have AFib.
1 liter out, 2 liters.
Okay, put the blood back in. There.
They found it! Incredible, so now they just need to fish it out and stop her dying from the 60 times overdose. As you saw, they cool her very quickly and you can do that safely. The key is on the warming up process. That can't go too quickly, otherwise you risk causing an abnormal heart rhythm or lack of blood flow to the brain. The advice can vary, but sticking to 0.5 and 1 degree of warming per hour is generally safe. Now, the benefits of hypothermia have been known since as early as 400 BC, when Hippocrates used to use snow and ice to reduce hemorrhage in patients. It's not until modern history, around the 40s and 50s, that this was mapped in a structured way. Now, we know that when patients whose heart has stopped, even for another reason, like a heart attack or stab wound to the chest from their wife because they wouldn't switch the channel to Love Island, therapeutic hypothermia at 35 degrees can preserve brain function for the patient. Nothing ice can do for a Love Island obsession.
4 millimeters lateral to the hippocampus. I saw it.
It's good enough for me.
There it is. I think I can get it.
You're treating your stuffy nose with cocaine.
They found it and pulled it out. Of course, none of this would happen in real life, but what an incredible case. Also, House is such an innovator. First, he invents a new procedure to discover where this patient's clot is. Then he decides, what's the point of using a pill or a nasal spray when you can just snort your medication? Genius. Now, a surprising number of meds can be ground down into a white powder like this and can look like cocaine to the untrained eye. Diphenhydramine is one, caffeine is another, and particularly popular are local anesthetics like lidocaine and procaine. That's because cocaine is actually a local anesthetic, and so are lidocaine and procaine. So mixing it with them can still make the user feel like they're getting the drug, even though it is diluted and they're getting the side effect, not the high that they paid for. Things I've mentioned so far are pretty innocuous, but some dealers actually mix cocaine with laundry detergent. If you thought that was bad, the detergent can get stuck inside the lining of the airways and cause inflammation and even lead to cancer. Cocaine isn't something you want to mess around with. I once saw a 22-year-old boy who put himself into heart failure from snorting too much cocaine and killing off a whole section of his left ventricle. Crazy. Question for you smart people. What is the most dangerous recreational drug based on lives claimed? Answers down below.
So her bravery was not a symptom.
I was wrong.
Could I test drive one of these things?
Oh, incredible. Wilson was taunting House about how that girl was really living life on the edge, stealing a kiss from Chase. He then asked House, what have you done recently? Clearly that got to him and he's decided to get himself an adrenaline rush. We all need that sometimes. That's why I'm also a snowboarding instructor. Nothing hits the reset button like a controlled fall down mobile terrain. Decent episode. There are definitely better ones in the series. Say 6.5 out of 10 for entertainment, 5 out of 10 for diagnosis, 5 out of 10 for accuracy. They still said that the cancer in the lung and heart were coincidences with no interconnected syndrome, and the whole hunt for the missing clot thing I really wanted to go along with, but it was a bit of a stretch. Now, if you want to watch a really good episode of House, then you should watch season 1 finale, where House has to treat his ex's new fiance right here.